Hi, welcome. We're going to talk about C++ in the embedded system field. This is sponsored by GearTex. That is a technology company, a personal brand that is specialized in the embedded systems and artificial intelligence using C++, C and Python. Okay. So first slide is we're going to recapture some concepts that we talked in previous videos. The video is called Embedded Systems Introduction, and those points are the first, the critical reliability. It means that it's expensive and it's potentially lethal to have any bug in the embedded systems. And the second one is that we have limited resources, that is critical to a computer in an airplane or a space probe. It might have a limit processing cycle. It can be just 16 megahertz, or it might have a memory, limit of 256 kilobytes. We might also be limited by the power supply. We might have a power supply interruption, so we need to handle it in a good way, because in the fourth point is that a system might work interruptedly for years, so we need to have as different ways to get powered it. In the third point, we are talking about the real-time response that is essential. Please remember how real-time is the concept that calling or having the output before the deadline is even more important than the correctness of the system. The fourth is that a function must system must function interruptedly for years. And the fifth point is that it's infeasible to have maintenance in different fields or different environments where the embedded system is set. So no bugs are allowed, while for example there is a ship in the major storm in the middle of the Pacific, you won't send any technician in there. So therefore, the embedded systems has the correctness concept that is producing results in the right time, in the right order, and only using an acceptable set of resources. About fault tolerance, we must be careful to specify the set of conditions that the program is supposed to handle. The third is that there is no deadline, not defined by the deadlines, and we have to run for a long time without changes to the software or intervention by skeletal operation. The fourth is the real-time constraints, that remember the hard real-time, if a certain response must occur before a deadline. The fifth is the predictability, and an operation is predictable if it takes the same amount of time to execute every time it's executed in different or given computers. And six is that embedded systems typically has to respond to various events from the external world at the same time. Okay, the concept of predictability, we discussed that there is instruction that might have to be compiled or executed in a specific fixed time. So the problem here is that standard containers are not able to be used, because they are indirectly using the free store. So they are not predictable either, called the string vector map list and so forth. They are very restricted in the embedded system world. We're not using also exceptions in the embedded systems. We are not able to use dynamic cast. About memory management, we have three different ways to allocate the memory. The first one is static, called global variables. They are allocated by the linker and persisting as long as the program runs. The second one is stack, or local variables in the function, maybe. And they are allocated when we call a function and free it when we return from the function. Stack memory can be a problem because it's possible to use too much of it. The third, dynamic, that is allocated by new and freed for possible reuse by deletion. The problems with stack and dynamic memory allocation, which are the stack, we need to be able to demonstrate that a chain of calls will never be too long because we have memory constraints. Therefore, you might want to prefer an iterative implementation instead of recursive implementation. Second point is that dynamic allocation is usually bound or reservedly restricted. In this case, in many implementations on new, the time needed to allocate a new object can increase dramatically after many objects have been allocated and deallocated. And we also have the concept of fragile, or fragment. That after allocation and deallocation objects, the remaining used memory might be fragmented into a lot or little holes of unused space that are useless because each hole is too small to hold another object of the kind used by the application. You can see in this image that we have let me do something. We have two different objects with different size. The orange is supposedly being smaller than the green one. So if we deallocate it, the orange one, we are not able to fill it with a green one. In this approach, we are iterating. We might have a lot of waste memory that in the embedded system is not correct. We have two alternatives to the free store problem that we saw here. And the first one is stack, last in, first out. It's a data structure where you can allocate an arbitrary amount of memory and deallocate the last allocation, only that function in the top. That's it, a static can grow and shrink only at the top, right? There cannot be fragmentation because there's not possible to have holes between two allocations. And the concept of a pool, that it's a collection of objects of the same size. So there's cannot be fragmentation because all objects are the same size. We talk about smaller and bigger. In the pool, they are the same size. Next is bit, byte, and word. And you might remember that a byte is 8 bits and is read by from the right to the left. We represent a set of bits in C++ in a Boolean. It's only used in one bit, but it takes the whole byte. In the char is a byte or 8 bits. In the short is 16 bits. In the int typically is 32 bits, but in embedded systems it's using 16 bits. In the long is using 32, or maybe have to use 64 bits. In the long is the same, that the long is 32 bits or 64 bits length. We have operation, bitwise operation. The OR is 7 bits, the AND is testing bits, the exclusive OR is toggling bits, and the left and the shift is moving the bits, and complementing changes the value of the whole byte or the whole number. Here you can see the complement on end that is changing the whole byte from 0 to 1 and 1 to 0. In the XOR we have a certain bit set of B and it's passing and it's toggling that relative of A, the result of the operation. Then it's testing if we have a 1. If we have a 1, it's being passed to the result. The left shift and the right shift is used to move a bit to the rightmost, and this is a way to have a easier way to access to that element, to value that element. In C++ we have a container called bit set. The bit set is a container with a fixed size as an array. So I was looking for a container to show bits in a lazy way, and this is the one that it's approachable to that goal. So the use of bit set is to represent and manipulate sets of bits. And when reading into a bit set, an input stream will look only for ones and zeros. You have any character different than that 1 0, that those that are going to be ignored. And the bitwise uses only unsigned int. If you wanted to have any feature or characteristic of the bits of bit set, you can search in the documentation. Okay, signing and unsigned int, obviously in the bit representation, if the most significant bit is 1, then it's negative, otherwise it's positive. That's the answer of that question, that how we distinguish between positive and negative numbers. In this way we have the signed, it might be the signed bit. And if we are moving the bits to the right in the signed number, the 1 remains instead of using the 0. And in signing int, if we are using the right shift, we are having zeros inserted. So we talk about two complement representation for negative numbers, and this is the complement to the positive number, and then you add a 1 to that number. We also have the formula of a range, the maximum number that you can represent in specific amount of bits. In this example we can have 2^15 minus 1, that is for integers, that the result is 32,767. That's the larger number that you can represent. As a review, the shift moves the bit considered bit to the rightmost. The max eliminates the bit that we don't want to pass. The set or sets new bytes, and the XOR is toggling the values of bit. Then we have the concept of bit folds, that is mixture of different types in the chunk of memory. This is represented by a strunk, a struct, and the 2 points with the following number is a limiter, so we are limiting the size of each member. In this case we have 22 bits unsigned int and unsigned int CCA with 3 bits. If we don't have a number like in this part, identifier of that member is that means that that part is skipped, so we are now using 3 bits. This is useful for macros, to frames, to messages passed by bit values. And that's it. We were based in the Programming Principle and Practice in C++ book by Mihir Strauss Group. So I think that you enjoyed. So thank you, and see you.